Good luck.
After
such good lunch, I think that we're happy to continue our work. And I would like to introduce you to Glaucoma Study Group with Cheryl, Linda, and Luke.
Thank you, Mike.
Good afternoon, everybody. As we were so nicely introduced, my name is Vishal, Linda, and Luke here. And our project for this summer was the study of the development of glaucoma. So we'll start by defining what glaucoma is. Now, lots of words there, don't worry about it. Glaucoma is a condition in the eye where the pressure increases, right? We call that the intraocular pressure, meaning the pressure inside the eye, it increases. And when that happens, the optic nerve, which is at the back of the eye, that becomes damaged. So you begin to lose sight then. So no information can go to the brain about what you're seeing. So this is the condition called glaucoma. Now, what causes glaucoma? Many people have different ideas about what causes glaucoma. And we, because we're part of the Center for Mathematical Medicine here at Fields, we decided to tackle this problem from a mathematical viewpoint. So what we wanted to do was model the flow of fluid in the eye. And in that, we hope to unlock some of the mystery behind what causes glaucoma. So how we did that, we took a couple of equations that incorporate fundamental properties about fluids, and we were able to develop a system of partial differential equations, which we then went on to solve. So first up, I'll just give you a general outline, a skeleton of what we did this summer, and then my colleagues here will fill in the skeleton, put the meat on it. Good. So the eye is a big thing when you think about it. We focused on one part of the eye, right? Which is the posterior chamber of the anterior part of the eye. Fancy words, but all that means is that, so the anterior part of the eye is the front pit here, okay? So this is the anterior part, the posterior is on this side. And we have to look at the posterior part of the anterior part. So the posterior part is this little chamber here. Okay, this little chamber. So we looked at the fluid flow in that little chamber there. Good? So a little bit more about glaucoma. So there are a couple forms of glaucoma, right? Two main types. One is called open-angle glaucoma. Now, open-angle glaucoma is more common. And what happens in that is that you slowly start to lose sight. The pressure slowly accumulates in your eye, and then the vision slowly goes away. Like that. And closed angle glaucoma is a more severe form. It's a rapid onset, right? People become blind in a short amount of time. But this closed angle one is less common. The more common one is the open angle one, and is usually accompanied with an increase in age. So once you're over 40, you have to go to the doctor once a year just to check the pressure in your eye, make sure you're not having glaucoma. And presently, there's no way to cure glaucoma. The only thing we can do is keep the pressure constant. There's no way we can send the pressure down. And there's no way to detect it early either, aside from measuring the pressure once in a while. So it's a very serious problem. Good, so this just here shows you again the area in which we were studying the fluid flow, right? If you notice the red line here pointing towards this posterior chamber. And on the next slide, there's a zoomed in picture here. So what happens is that fluid is produced here, and this here is called the ciliary process. So fluid in the eye is produced there. What it does, it flows through the posterior chamber in the direction of this arrow, right? So it flows through there. Then, if you go back one, please. Then, so it'll flow through here, and then there's a narrow slit here, and the fluid comes out here and enters this big anterior chamber. And then what happens after that is that the fluid drains off into something called Schlemm's canal. And it's exactly what it sounds like, just a canal. So it is produced here, it goes through the posterior chamber, into the anterior chamber, and then out through Schlemm's canal. So this is the path that the fluid takes, and we have to model the fluid flow here. Good. So a little bit about the fluid in the eye. So the fluid has a special name, and it's called the aqueous humor. And what that is responsible for, humor doesn't mean funny in this case. It's humor. Right? So what the aqueous humor does is that it provides shape to the eye. This nice spherical shape that you have is because of the aqueous humor. And it fills that front part of the eye. it fills just that front part of the eye, gives it shape, gives it support. It also is responsible for nourishing the inside of the eye. And we have a couple of stats here on it. It's produced at a rate of 2.7 microliters per minute in the daytime when you're awake, and about half as much is produced at night. So I mentioned at the beginning that the equations that we took incorporated fundamental aspects about the fluid. And one of the fundamental things is the conservation of momentum. And this is mapped out in the Navier-Stokes equations. Also, another fundamental thing with the fluid is the conservation of mass. Fairly obvious, we can't lose any mass, otherwise the eye will become deformed. And this is modeled by the continuity equation. So on this slide here, we have the Navier-Stokes equation in vector form. So this is really three equations, because the eye is a three-dimensional object. And then this is also in vector form, the conservation of mass, or the continuity equation. There are a couple conditions under which these equations hold. And we assume a Newtonian fluid, laminar flow, isotherm. All that means is that it is valid for what is happening in the eye. So the aqueous humor satisfies these three conditions, and by so doing, we can use these to model the fluid flow. However, these Navier-Stokes equations, they seem quite long, and they are quite long, and it's very complex to deal with. So what we had to do was make an approximation. And in order to make that approximation, we use something called lubrication theory. And this is where I will finish up and allow Linda to tell you more about.
So as Rochelle mentioned at the beginning, our objective is to model the fluid flow in the posterior chamber of the eye. So in order to do that, that seems like a really complicated problem. In order to do that, we did a survey of literatures that's regarding similar problems. So just to go back, fluid flow in the eye is generated in a ciliary process through the posterior chamber. It passes through the pupil aperture and then going to the anterior chamber and brings through the Schlemm's canal. Now, as you can see here, anterior chamber is the only other chamber that aqueous humor have passed through, right? So let's see some literatures that have done some modeling for the anterior chamber. First of all, where is the anterior chamber? It is right here. It is between, here's the cornea of the eye. So it is between the cornea of the eye and the iris part of the eye. So it can also be noted that the cornea is porous. That means it's permeable for some aqueous humor to seek through that and go to the outside. And also from clinical observations, the fluid flow in the anterior chamber appears to be driven by temperature gradient. So the first paper that have done this will be by Kenny et al. So here's their model. As you can see, here's like a person that's lying down where Z is going outside the eye, and here's the cornea, where here's the pupil aperture, and here's the iris. So we have X going down. Now, how we model it is that this is what Michelle mentioned at the beginning of the Navier-Stokes equation. However, they include it here. This is the Poussin-esque approximation, which is, as Michelle mentioned at the beginning, that Navier-Stokes equation can only use for isothermal flow, which means that when the temperature is the same. However, as I mentioned from the beginning, there is a temperature gradient. So this part takes care of that along with this equation here. Now, their axis is that the person is standing in an upright position, and gravity here acts in the positive x direction. So what they did is that they non-dimensionalized, and using lubrication theory, they reduced their equation to five simple equations here. I'll explain more about non-dimensional stabilization later, since it is is a method that a lot of physicians use. So they also, we all know that in order to solve these solutions, we need boundary conditions. They have no slip Klein conditions on the Z of H of XY, this is a cornea, and no slip on the iris of the eye. And also we have two temperature boundary conditions on the two sides. Now this is what they got. This is their solution. So as you can see, basically their streamline is that this is a cross section of the anterior chamber of the eye. So the fluid flow goes in this direction, in which case it rises near the back of the eye, here is hotter here, so therefore it rises, and here it lowers down. And if they were also conclude that small temperature difference can drive a flow. Now, this is only a simple